good morning. I'm going to talk about OAuth microservices and a lot of other stuff. My name is Thomas Klausner, or Tom. Website and Twitter thing. I'm from a monogroup called bicycle.pm, so yes, I started here. Which is not that big achievement because I was living in Vienna. Most of the code I'm showing was developed for this company. I'm actually a freelancer. First, a short confession. I didn't know that. That's a screenshot from I Can't Dance from Genesis. So I have no idea about Dancer. It was like one dance application when it came out a few years ago. So this talk is not going to be very heavy on the Dancer stuff. But what this talk is about stateless REST microservice APIs using OAuth token-based authentication optimization. Bullshit video. If you want, I have some bullshit video cards here. You know, just grab one of those and tick off all of the cool hot phrases I mentioned. And if you finish first, you get a row or a column or diagonally, you can get some cool prizes. You can also get some cool prizes if you don't ask any meaningful context questions. So you can start ticking already. So monolith versus microservices. So monolith, you know that is it's a big application, big box. You probably want to structure your monolith using something called monolayers, like monolith controller or some other things. You also layer your monolith vertically, so you have different areas of the application. And if you do that, you hopefully have something that you have request and spits below some HTML, and in the meantime, the code goes, you have something like that. It's very nice, it's really easy to understand it, and it's all cool, but in the end, you always end up with something like that. A big mess of code. I'm doing that for a long time, and I try to keep it clean and simple and sleep to the layers, but in the end, it always gets complicated. Then you have stuff like tight coupling, which is everything is somehow interconnected together, and if you change something over here, something over there, it starts to break. Monolith is of course also resource handling because it's one big thing. It's very hard to escape because it's one big box. And it's a big code base, so if you want to really know what's going on, you basically know all of it in your brain, and it's hard to get people to know that and teach them how to use it. So, microservice is the new hot shit currently. It's like that. So instead of one big box, you have a lot of small boxes. You can also layer them. And then usually you have some API requests come in and you spit out some JSON. You also have some complex stuff going in there. The idea or the hope is that in the end it looks more like this and not like it could still look like that. So you still have to be careful. But so the idea is to have this nicer, saner architecture that's easier to understand. And even this should be easier to understand than that. At least that's the view. Okay. So, of course, microservice already failed once under the name of service-oriented architecture. So if you remember it from like thousands, but that was XML, so the ISDN and stuff like that. So maybe it failed because of that, or it just failed because all software is bound to fail. So one important thing that Mark Fowler, Martin Fowler, who wrote a lot of text on microservices and other stuff, says that do the monolith first. So if you want to avoid this intended mess of microservices, then you should maybe start the monolith first. You know that. And if you know how everything works, then you can start to break it apart into microservices. That's a very good advice, I think. Until now, I've split up one monolith into microservices. I have never started with microservice architecture from scratch, so I cannot say if it's true. But Martin Fowler is a very smart guy, so I guess he can hear on parts. In the end, you cannot get rid of complexity. You have this complicated stuff that's going on, and if you pack it in a monolith or you pack it in a microservice, it's still going to be complex. So, sorry. But that's our job, that's why we can charge what we can charge, because we try to manage this complexity. And I think microservices are a good tool to manage all of this complexity. Another big complicated thing is called this fat front end. So back when I started doing web development ages ago, it looked like this. You have a browser, it has a GET request, so thing, it's a database, it spits out some HTML, and then you display some stuff. That's how web development was back then, and that's how a lot of web development is still happening now, but we have this thing that JavaScript suddenly got usable. Smartphones and smart apps and stuff suddenly appeared, mobile internet became a thing, client devices got more powerful, and now we can do that. So we have a browser, inside the browser, a very big JavaScript application. And the JavaScript application does API requests to your services, gets some JSON back, and updates it. It's like one big static thing. You don't have page reloads, you don't send HTML around all the time. So that's like the new thing, not very new anymore, but a newish thing also how to implement your own applications. You can still do stuff like that. You have microservices calling other microservices, it's also going to happen. But the nice thing is, because you can pop your device, like a mobile device, using the same APIs, get the same JSON back, exactly the same. And you can also do more stuff like that. If you already have this fat front end, you can call different applications altogether. So you have your application up there, and another application down there, which could be some third party startup thing you're using from there. Okay, another big thing that's going to be the topic of this talk is OAuth 2 allows you to give an application some rights to use another application on your behalf. Very handy for microservices. It can also be used or used as an authentication system, which is what OpenID Connect is. So if you talk about OAuth 2, most people think about that often think about authentication here or OAuth. So you have this login page of some application, and then there you have this login with Google or Facebook links. You click on a link, you go into Google, you authenticate there. Google asks you, do you really want to grant this application that rights to use your account? And then assuming you click yes and agree and everything, you're going back to the application you came from. But now you are not here. So that's what most of you think of here OAuth 2, and that's of course a very important part of it, but that's a lot of it. So a lot of stuff is happening in the background, which I didn't show you in these few images. You can watch a free dance performance of this process here on this YouTube video. So we did a lightning talk at the UPSI in Europe 2 years ago on how the OAuth engine works. Free dance performance. I'm not going to show it to you now, you can watch it. It's fun. Anyway, so after you do this OAuth 2 handshake thingy, the user is logged in at Google, the user is also logged in at your site. Without needing a password for your site, so that's one big benefit. You don't have to, you cannot even leave passwords if you don't have them anymore. You have an access token for Google or whatever the big service you're using. And there's a talk later, I think, on social logins and legal and security implications. So this whole process I showed you is called the web server flow or authorization code flow. And that's what most of us are doing. But there are two other very interesting flows. One is called the client-side flow, aka pop-up flow, or implicit grant. Here, a JavaScript front-end handles the login, probably as an SDK or something like that. The big fat service, we just want to have an access token directly to a JavaScript front-end. In the fragment of the URL, so the backend, if you have a backend, has no way of seeing the actual code. And the front-end extracts the code from the URL and can or should verify that the code is valid, and if it is, it can use the tool and store it in the local storage. Coming to that later. So the installed applications flow, it's very useful for scripts and daemons. That's when you have something that, like a script, that needs to use your service. So the script will tell the user to go to your URL to log in. Wait for the user ID authorization code. If the login is successful, the backend will handle the code to the user. After pasting that code back to your script or service, the service will do an OAuth handshake, and then you see an access token and a refresh code. And these tokens can now be used to access the APIs. So a little bit later. So using the token, if you have your token, you can use it in the URL, which is not that nice, or the cooler method is to have an authorization header of type Vera, so you can have it all. The reason why this is nice is it doesn't show up an exit log, it's just the same way you can keep your ends nice. But it's a Vera token, error token, I don't know how to pronounce that. So the access token itself could be used like a session string. So the backend puts down a token somewhere. On each request, the backend retrieves the state from some storage. And so, but that's not very stateless. You can have state because the backend has to remember which token does what. It has to look up a database or a cache or something. So you could just as well use session cookies. To make the backend really stateless, you can use jobs. Jobs. There's an IRC where you can read all about it. So a job looks like that, so it's a very long string. In fact, it's basically three strings concatenated together with a dot. Each of these parts is 64 URL encoded. And the three parts are called the header, the body, claims, and the signature. The headers tell us how the claims are encrypted or signed. The body is a hash of claims, for example, user ID, expiration date, whatever. And the signature is a signature, which you use to make sure that whoever issued that hands you the token hasn't tampered. So if you decode it, you just base 64 decoded, then you get the algorithm that's used to sign it, then you get whatever is in the actual claims. For example, here we have some issue with Joe, and whoever has this token is root, and there's an expiration date, and then the signature, which makes sure that if I change something in there, the backend can verify that this token wasn't handled. Yeah, of course, there's in Prime we have JSON Web Token and some other modules to unpack it. So to use it, you pass the token and distribute it to this method and you get back the claims. It's very simple. JSON Web Decoder also has a very strange way to just inspect the token. So claims. There are a few official claims defined in the RFC, but you can always add more. The most important is the sub, that's the subject of the token, which is like the user ID or who is the owner of this token. The issuer, who issued the token, so you can figure out if this token is coming from me or from another member. So it's the audience for whom this token is relevant. Expiration time and some other stuff. And some more time, some other stuff. And as I said, you can add whatever you want. So JOTs are very cool tokens as compared to just some random strings because they can be signed, they can be encrypted. There is another standard where you can do an actual PGP encoded style stuff of the token so the user cannot inspect it without having the private key. Of course, it's a little bit more complicated than setup. So if you're an API and you receive a JOT, you can just verify the signature, look at the claims, and do whatever you or the caller wants to do. You don't have to look at the database because if the token was tampered with and all the information in the token is valid, you can just do whatever you want. You don't have to store the state anywhere. So you get true stateless backends, which makes a lot of stuff much simpler. So there's a live demo, but it's not fun watching me type, so I create a demo. So the setup, I have an OAuth server, like one we wrote ourselves, running on this machine on that URL. The JavaScript application is coming from somewhere, who cares? The JavaScript application talks to some API, also running on that machine on some other spot, could be a different host name. This API needs to talk to other APIs, so it needs to use the installed application for to authorize itself. And there's a lot of other APIs in microservices, like I'm showing just one, it's called Commons. So when I actually start the application, which is like, you know, you start with the backend. I get this text, so it tells me to go to this URL. This is the client ID of the application. probably seen it if you're using something like Trello or a lot of services you said you want to have offline access to your whatever backend. So take this URL, copy it into the browser, and then you get a login page. So I enter my stuff. And then I get some sort of code. This code actually, it's not a token, it's a proper code that's actually stored in the database. It has to be more secure than just a stateless token. So that one is in the database and can be set to, is used, and you can use it only once. So I paste it in here, and after paste the code, the application continues to start. What it did, So this application, this backend, is now authorized at the authorization server, and the backend can call backend-to-backend calls to this other API, which are authorized, and I can revoke access for this application to the backend because I have a user, or without sharing the actual password. So the password is only entered in the application. I don't have to have some passwords distributed in my log file. The front end pop-up flow. So I have an application. I want to log in. And what you can see here, what you can see over here, so when I click on the login button here, a new pop-up show opens up, a new window with a totally different application here, which is the authorization backend basically, so you are here, and after you log in, you get the access token in here, and you redirect back to this, to the same application as you came originally. The reason for the pop-up is it's very, 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 very annoying to have cookies issued for other domains. If you ever tried that, it's really, really horrible. You have to find the cause, and you have to find a lot of other stuff. And the browsers change their behavior all the time because all of it's good to do it because it's for security reasons. They do it for a reason. But the one workaround, which is why we have this pop-up flow, is that you can avoid all that stuff. So anyway, so you get this access token over here, and on in the JavaScript application, there's a JavaScript code kind of running sort of like that, that looks for this token, this string. So it looks at the access token and some stuff over here, and if it matches, it stores the token in the local storage and calls the login function of the JavaScript front end, which does stuff which we don't care about. So and in the end, I'm looking here. And the pop-up disappeared again. So the pop-up is closed. And if you inspect the local storage, you can see that the local storage we have a token, which the JavaScript frontend can now use to do whatever it wants to do. So to call even more APIs, I probably need some other tokens for the other APIs. So our author writes me to get those other tokens. That's the author. And I can say I want a token for this other service. To get the token, to be allowed to actually get it, I have to provide a token which is valid for this server. So I send this token to this server to get a token for another service. And if I do that, I get some JavaScript back which includes yet another token for this service. Which decoded looks like that. So you see you have the audience, which is the same as the name of the application. And in here you have basically the user ID of the user who is allowed, who is the owner of this token. Of course, this request I just showed you, which was pure code, could be issued by any HTTP client. If you have this token, I could fax it to you. You type it down and you request and get the same results. There's no matching, it's just a code. and package the any, for example, in the JavaScript application. So the JavaScript application basically does the same thing, which I showed you as a curl here, right? Just takes a token, posts a request, gets a model, which makes it very easy to play around with these APIs, because you just have to do them in command line, you don't have to fill in big forms in the browser or whatever. It was very easy for testing. So anyway, so now I can use that token for the this command API. So the comments API for that, so awesome. There's comments and I have some theme which I want to comment on. I again have the token and I call the endpoint and then I get back the evolution. I'm sorry, we don't have any comments yet on this topic. Count zero, for example. What we're using here is this thing here is higher, but that's something. It's a sort of standard to provide links between. Tries to find a mirror token in there, and if it has one, it selects it first. So it doesn't actually verify the signature, because at this point we cannot verify the signature because we do not know the secret of this application. We just select it, and then get the audience of our claims or tokens, and call get client with this thing, and get client basically does some caching, but then it uses the database to look for this API. So in our in the database, we can say, is this API configured as a secret? Is it allowed to access? Which of course makes sense if you have a lot of, if you don't have one customer but hundreds of customers. So we have this, it's like this common service, we can have a lot of different applications talking to it. If it is, we prepare a data structure, cache data structure, and if it's not, we return an HTTP error and say it's an invalid API. So now when we actually find the client, we can now get the secret of this client, and now we can decode the job and see if this job hasn't been tampered with because the secret and the algorithm match, and we can decode. If we do, we can extract the code in the database and store it in the environment. The PSGIX environment. And then we also we just get all the data we can out of the token of the app and store it in the environment. So in the end, we have those environment keys. Then we can later use our application for whatever we want. Stuff like that. Of course, I can't bother to remember this exact string. So Sputnik, so without traffic case or not. So we have a role, pre-using our request class, which basically just provides easier accesses to this environment parameters. So I can say more token to get to the other token. This thing is now actually the controller that implements handling. That's the request class. So this is a subclass that basically wraps an HTTP request into a lot of layers and provides additional functionality. There's something called aux request, which is the basic request of aux. We have example some stuff, loading some other rules in here. So we can do higher stuff and more serial token thing. And now we have action controller action, I can see rate of what token instead of that. So it's nicer to respect some stuff into the code. One very helpful method this role provides is requires a lot of claims up, which basically you need to make sure that you have a valid sub. So So in the controller that actually handles this post, which I talked about like some time ago, looks like that. So that's the implementation of storing the academic parameters. Sorry, use requires of frame sub to get the user, which is just the sub to the tool or anything like this. If this thing is not valid or they have it just die here and return a not authorized HTTP exception. But if we have the user, we can get the data from the payload and then create a new comment with that user and the data. summary is, so this can manage capacity, or the two is a very good protocol to implement authorization and authentication. And token-based authentication is a very, it's complex in the beginning and it takes some time to wrap your head around it, but it really can make things a lot better.